Next topic is management of head and neck trauma patient by Dr. Sumit Kalra. He is associate consultant in pain and perioperative medicine at Sir Gangaram Hospital, New Delhi.
Good morning, family. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you, Shiv sir, and the team Gujarat to give me a chance to speak here. Like my friend has said, where is the money? I'll say in head and neck trauma, where is the evidence? Because we'll start, you read the ATLS or NICE guidelines or whichever is coming up, just 3 or 4 class 1 evidence maximum. Nothing else works. Everything else is practice options or non-randomized controlled trial proven theories. So we'll start with the mechanism of injury. Most common being RTAs, alcohol being a major factor, fall in the elderlies, assault, followed by sports injuries. Sports injuries is very, very common. There recently one being a Dutch cyclist who just lost the race. She was leading by 6 miles in an 87-mile hill race and she fell down and sustained the cervical fractures with concussion. She woke up in the ICU to realize she has lost it. How do we classify injuries? There are multiple classifications, confusing terminologies, most of all for, I think PG should know. But for us, the main important one is based on the severity, which is mild, moderate, and severe based on the Glasgow Coma Score. Some say Glasgow Coma Scale. It's the same thing. Scale is the whole thing. Score is what you score for the patient. 3 being the minimum and 15 being the highest. This is the Glasgow Coma Score. It's recently completed 40 years. You can Google GCS at 40, find beautiful videos on YouTube to realize what has changed. The sternal rub is out. Nobody does it. It is not recommended. The nipple pinch out. Don't do it. You're assaulting the patient. What has come up is the response to pain has changed from response to pressure. If you look at the eye-opening response, to pain has changed to pressure. And the pressure is exerted on the nail bed. You can use a pen and exert pressure on the nail bed. The trapezius pinch can happen. You can pinch the trapezius and pressure on the supraorbital medial margin. They are the three only ones which are currently advocated by the Professor Teasdale and et al. Who gave GCS in the first place. Followed by the confusion part being the verbal response. Some people inappropriate, incomprehensible, you can do much, but it has been refined to words and sounds. Followed by when you note down GCS, the best thing which can predict outcome is the motor response. So the best motor response in the best limb should be noted, although you have to note the actual response in all the limbs to take home the message ki what is the recovery, what is the state of the patient. This is a very important slide, like Dr. Vikas just, you know, he helped me easing my job. But he said you have to insert 2 tubes. When not to insert 2 tubes, this is the slide. Okay, this is the signs of basal cell fracture, the raccoon eyes, the periorbital ecchymosis, the battle sign, the retroauricular ecchymosis, followed by CSF, otorrhea, rhinorrhea, or blood coming out of ear or nose. This signs, irrespective of the patient's GCS, patient is considered to be having severe head injury. He may be walking into with those eyes with that sign, but he is severe head injury. Guard him, take him to the triage. Don't put anything through the nose. Somebody put it, and this is what happened. This is a Ryle's tube in the brain. So this is that's why it is a red alert, because gastric tube insertion is one of the first reflex. You come, patient higher trauma, dalo, Ryle's tube, dalo, Foley's, dalo. No, don't put it, please. Classification as primary and secondary, this is the third classification we're talking about here, but this is important. Why? Because the management protocols of ATLS are based on these guidelines. So primary injury occurs at the time of trauma and manifested in milliseconds. Basically, the aim is to prevention. Political policies, drive safely, don't drink and drive. Secondary injury occurs in minutes, hours, or days after the impact and represents the complicating processes. My talk is just 10 minutes, so I'm not going with the pathophysiology, the excitotoxicity. I'm just giving you the reasons, the secondary insults, which can cause hypoxic or which can cause ischemic damage. There are plenty of go-to. The main target of our management is to prevent and treat the secondary insult. That is the primary goal of management. The pre-hospital phase is primitive in India. It is, I think, non-existent. Auto wala leke aata hai patient mostly, na? So there's no point. But the West is definitely ahead of us, and they are doing studies at the level that pre-hospital-led teams, they improve outcome. They say the intubations have increased in the pre-hospital phase, but we have improved outcome. And the standard ABCD and embolize and immediate transport for the patient has already been covered by Dr. Vikas. ER evaluation is a standard protocol starting with the ample mnemonic of history, alcohol, this all has been covered. The main important point for a patient with head injury is a CT scan, which should be done ASAP. And with the current medico-legal litigation coming up, cervical spine is by default included if it is a suspected dangerous mechanism of injury. These are the most common CT scan in TBI we see. The epidural hematoma and the subdural hematoma followed by contusions and intraperitoneal with midline shift. The all four may not go for surgery. The top two will definitely need surgery. The last one will need surgery because of the midline shift. These are the patients who are tricky. These are the patients where you start with that stage one, stage two, or tier zero, tier one therapy of ICP control. We'll come to that. Starting with the management of minor traumatic brain injury. These are patients are GCS 13 to 15. They are awake, they are oriented. They are awake, they are oriented. I'm repeating it because it is important. There's no history of loss of consciousness, no vomiting, amnesia, or seizures. You don't do CT in all of them. The West, and I think we follow them, they are obsessed with rules and guidelines, which are useful, but sometimes they are a bit of overkill. So this is one Canadian guidelines, this is one New Orleans guidelines. They more or less convey the same message when to do a CT in a patient with minor traumatic brain injury, which I have summarized in the indications for hospital admission. If you're doing a CT, you might admit him for observation, there's no harm. There's clinical evidence of skull fracture, alcohol, drug intoxication, significant extracranial injuries, abnormal GCS score, amnesia. When the mechanism of injury is not trivial, the co-passenger has died, you will admit the person who has not died, but you seem to be minor, admit him. He has ejected from a seat, he has fallen from a horse, he has fallen from a recreational motor vehicle. These are all dangerous mechanism injuries. Even a patient where no scan is available, admit him. When there is no reliable companion at home, admit him. These are social factors. And whenever you send these patients home, you give them a discharge instructions. This is an example of a discharge, warning discharge instruction sheet, which is handed over to the caregiver and the patient. Both of them are explained. Any of the symptoms are presented, report back to the hospital or call 911 or 100 in India. Coming on to the management of moderate TBI, the GCS score target is here 9 to 12. Always admit these patients, always do a CT scan. Urgent neurosurgery consult is mandatory, and follow-up CT scan and frequent neuro assessments have to be done either before discharge, which happens in most of the cases, and if the patient deteriorates, they have to be managed on the guidelines of severe traumatic brain injury. The severe TBI, the ABCD primary secondary survey has already been covered. It basically further includes a CT scan mandatorily and from an urgent neurosurgery consult to an emergent neurosurgery consult. You have to get it done ASAP, call the neurosurgeon. Wherever he is, come see this patient, this is yours. And I'll just touch upon the basic ABCD modifications which need to be done for a traumatic brain injury patient, because you presume the patient is having cervical spine injury. Like Dr. Guru yesterday showed an image of him intubating with a CMAC and a friend of his ready with a surgical clitoridectomy blade. This is a standard image in the ATLS book, and it shows four people, one giving a manual inline stabilization, you can see these two hands here, the one with the black watch, one oxygenating, the one giving a required pressure, and the fourth one is injecting drugs. So this is the entire portion of the cervical collar is removed. That has to be noted. You can give any agent, whatever you used to, but avoid hypotension and be as fast as you can. In breathing, the target is to maintain adequate oxygenation. SpO2 below 90% is associated with poor outcome. And treat hypoxia. The recent literature has shown even hyperoxia is very, very bad, and I think this was told yesterday also. And normocapnia is the current rule. There is no role for any hyperventilation strategy until unless there is impending herniation. We'll come to that. Coming on to circulation, Brain Trauma Foundation guidelines is all we have right now in dedicated brain trauma. So they give, this is a class one, almost a class one evidence that to avoid hypotension and maintain systolic BP of 90, the target is to maintain euvolemia, because hypovolemia can be masked by a stable BP because of the Cushing's response. So you have to be guided by urine output and CVP. Although CVP is not that great a marker, they say these days pulse pressure variation is a more significant marker of volume cessation. Isotonic non-glucose crystalloid. You say that there's a class on neurosurgery, fluids in neuroanesthesia. You listen to the whole class for 1 hour and then come to the OT and give NS. So this is this. Neurosurgery means NS. As of now, there's the new fluid has come up in India, plasma light, which is somewhat similar. It's an isotonic crystalloid, but the studies have still to be come to prove it useful in neurosurgery. Roles of colloids is controversial. The SAFE trial has proved albumin to be unsafe, so there's no role for that. As far as hypertonic saline is concerned, it is beneficial in small amount, although its role in pre-hospital restriction is more than what it is in the intra-hospital. Vasopressors, there's no evidence to support that is one perfect choice, but there's an inclination towards norepinephrine and phenylephrine. Transfusion, as far as it goes, there was a concept of liberal transfusion which is now outdated, and it should be treated on case-to-case basis and as per institution protocols. At our institute, we normally transfuse for a young patient below 7 or 7.5. When and how do we manage ICP? The things in red are in the Brain Trauma Foundation guidelines. As Dr. Nevin has previously mentioned, how many of us actually put ICP monitor? So we may not be following it. So that's why all the trials which are coming out, DECRA trial, and they may not be validated with a life or a kind of practice. But still, for theoretical state, you have to start treating ICP if it's more than 20, and you have to maintain the CPP from 50 to 70. They are the guidelines. These are the various ways you monitor the ICP, ventriculostomy catheter, and the subdural bolt, will be the most common ones. So how do we manage ICP? Some say tier 1, tier 2, stage 1, stage 2. Eventually, the class 1 evidence is of common sense, which is the tier 0 therapy. This works always. Head up position up to 30 degrees in head in neutral position works. Mechanical ventilation to achieve normocapnia works. Analgesia, sedation, muscle relaxants, you basically calm down the patient, it works. Normal temperature and sugar, often forgotten, are of prime importance. No role of hypothermia as of now. Coming to tier 1 therapy, this is more of a theoretical thing, ventriculostomy with or without cesarean. Everything has class 2 evidence, nothing here has class 1 evidence except for the last point. It's like there is an expanding hematoma, you have the reason for raised ICP, take it out, patient will wake up. So, osmotherapy, mannitol or hypertonic saline, as per the institute protocol, whichever is preferred, can be used. Mild hyperventilation until you wheel in the patient for surgical OT, that is for that thing only. Starting with tier 2 therapy, decompressive kinectomy has been proven with unfavorable outcome in the DECRA trial. But then again, the DECRA trial was based on ICP measurement. And this is the most recent article we have right now from Kramer in January this year, which says that the decompressive kinectomy was performed for clinical and radiographic evidence rather than ICP. So results do not directly apply to the population we study. And recently, the results of the rescue ICP and the rescue ASDS trials are expected, and they will, I hope they will support decompressive, because this is, DECRA trial was overkill for decompressive. Second point, hypothermia. Hypothermia was in picture because of a corollary. Hypothermia is bad, it increased cerebral metabolic rate. So by default, hypothermia should be good. That was the concept behind it. They did many, many studies. The Japanese were more ahead of us. They did a Japanese data neurobank survey and introduced one more term to confuse us. Therapeutic normothermia, as if you were burnt, confused with already with mild, moderate and severe hypothermia. They gave one more term, therapeutic normothermia for diffuse and therapeutic hypothermia for mass evacuation. The recent Eurotherm study which has come has put the last nail in the coffin for hypothermia, and it has shown it does not improve outcome and should not be given. Even by trained centers, this is the final nail in the coffin. So hypothermia has gone out.
So please conclude in 5 minutes.
Yes, I'll be finishing. Thank you. Followed by high dose barbiturate therapy for refractory patients should be done only in centers which are used to doing it, and moderate hyperventilation only in cases of impending herniation. SGVO2 monitoring is recommended, but it is again of doubtful benefit. Is there a tier 3 therapy? Is there something which else can be done? There's a concept of decompressive laparotomy. It's a novel concept. There have been studies since 5-6 years right now. And they think the body is made up of interconnected compartments, and the compartment syndrome of the brain leads to ICP rise. So they say thoracotomy, laparotomy, even lower down fasciotomy helps in relieving ICP. We need more trials or more studies on this. Steroids are not at all recommended. Blood glucose control, they say the target, there is no concept of tight control. The target is to have anything below 200 is good. Anti-seizure prophylaxis is recommended for early prevention of seizures, but it does not prevent the late onset ones. Nutrition, the full caloric replacement should be achieved by day 7 of admission. The general ICU care goes a long way in improving outcome from DVT prophylaxis to stress ulcer prophylaxis to positioning, physiotherapy, care of lines and catheters. What else is new? This non-invasive monitoring has come up a big way, and optic nerve sheath diameter is useful in detecting raised ICP, in monitoring, and as well in as a quick prognosticator marker, even for patients with pediatric patients to adult patients. Every patient, this is good. It is typically measured about 3 millimeter from the globe. A value more than 5.8 is considered to be corroborating with ICP of 20. The other one is transcranial Doppler. It is useful in determining early prognosis, and as a non-invasive school, as looks promising with the results. There's something called as impact brain apnea. Patient collapses and dies, come to workup, the CT is normal, and you don't know why he died. So they say that he died because he had an impact. This is an entity known since 1705, and the trauma causes, the impact causes apnea. It is sometimes associated with a catecholamine surge, which leads to hypertension and cardiovascular collapse. So all you need to do in such cases is open the airway, assist ventilation, put in a tube, take him a moment later, he'll wake up in a day, the CT will be normal. So this is one thing. This is a recent article, this is still in press. I just got it through some online link. So this is something which you should be in mind. Coming on to neck trauma, I'll just cover the 2-3 important points in this, because cervical spine injury is one, which is the most important, vascular injury and penetrating injuries. The management is as the standard protocol of ABCD, immobilize the spine, immobilize the spine, immobilize the spine. That is the rule in cervical spine trauma. How do you predict the patient may have a cervical spine trauma? This is a Canadian C-spine rule, and the current NICE guidelines of February this year, they tell that if you use this rule, you can predict the probability of patient having a cervical neck trauma. So I'll just constrained on the high risk part, that the high risk people are the elderly, and if the dangerous mechanism is involved, and they spare ascesia. And the last point in the low risk, if a patient is able to move his neck left and right 45 degrees, he is normal, the neck is okay, leave him. The immediate destination is always a major trauma center until you need to put some emergency and you have to take him to a nearest trauma unit. Imaging is always a CT and an X-ray. Remove the collar if the C-spine is normal. If the imaging is normal, when in doubt, don't take it out. The spine specialists are involved at early stage. There is no role of methylprednisolone in any kind of spine trauma or spine surgery whatsoever. This is the recent guidelines. If the patient has to be taken for emergency surgery before a spine workup, the C collar should be left on, but the spine board should be removed. The patient with a suspected spinal injury should never be left on a spinal board. You may cause impending bed sore in a paraplegic patient or a quadriplegic patient. So remove the spine board. Spine board is removed with this four people log roll technique, which is shown in the figure. And the OT team, the anesthetist, and the surgeon should be informed about the status of the C-spine workup. In conclusion, the main aim of management of head and neck trauma is to manage the secondary insults, and it requires a coordinated effort between the emergency physicians, the neurosurgeons, intensivists, and obviously the anesthetists. In the end, it's all about teamwork. Thank you so much. Any questions are welcome, please.
Thank
you. Yesterday I mentioned about the CRASH II trial.
Yeah.
Tranexamic acid.
I'll just take 10 seconds, sir. Yeah, tranexamic acid is very much into, it's coming up. Tranexamic acid in the pre-hospital system, if people are trained, or at the hospital when patient arrives within 3 hours, it has to be given. It has shown no doubt to that it reduces mortality and morbidity. And the best combat trauma which we are following in the Northern Command, that is 92 base hospital, Garg sir will know that, they are giving actually tranexamic acid at their place, and they have found reduced morbidity and mortality. And I'm sure they'll come up with some data also.
There was a confusion. Yeah. I mean, I just wanted to also clarify in my talk yesterday when I mentioned tranexamic acid, many of you thought I was talking about use of tranexamic acid in elective arthroplasty, hip and knee replacement. So yesterday it was the same thing what he mentioned. It is on trauma. When given early is beneficial, but when given late is harmful.
The other thing is trauma patients are usually young, and it may not be appropriate for all the elderly patients having elective surgery. Like someone was talking about giving cesarean patient tranexamic acid and then subsequently having a very bad outcome. Like the patient actually had clotting problems and then subsequently died.
Ma'am.